From the town of Detroit where my job is secure, yeah. Securing the fact now that it's gone for good, yeah. So I scrimp and I'll scrape at this pension I saved. So it should be gone by the end of the day. Get a power's out. Is there no way to say? Get a power's out.
Valley circle blocks till I'm busy.
Put me up in the silver and roll me in gold, yeah. Mix up this whiskey till it's nice and cold, yeah. Forgive me for dreaming, it's all I have left.
And we're back, man. Shamrock Show episode 15. More than honored to be sitting here with my man Ed Brady. Made the trek down from distant Rhode Island.
You know what, man? It's an honor to be here. Old friend, we go back a ways. We had a lot of fun, and you know, I was honored when you asked me, so I'm glad I got the invite.
Nah, man. When I first thought of doing this, right? So I started last March, and I had a couple people. Like, you were in the list of people who I'm like, all right, well, who could I do? And like my first five people who came in my head, just because I knew that having you on would be fun, and that you got a lot of cool stuff to do. I got a shout out real quick. Proper 12 Whiskey. We're cheering a little bit here. With
yeah,
a little,
man. Big win the other night, huh?
Toast. Yeah,
he's
yeah.
Back.
So the last show we did was right before Connor's last fight. Came out and stomped him in 40 seconds, which is dope. He's got this new hoodie from Proper 12. Also, shout out for that. And shout out to the law offices of Scott D. Camassar and Stephen Reck, man. Big friends of the show. If you've ever get in a car accident or anything, hit them up, man. So
can't do it without the sponsors, right?
Can't do it without the sponsors.
Absolutely.
Man. And they're great people, so... Without further ado, Ed Brady, the arguably the first but top two most famous Bradys in New England.
Oh man, yeah, I don't know. I don't know if I can. You know what was cool about Tom Brady though was I got the Brady Bunch my whole life, so I got the rat end of that joke. Oh, you part of the Brady Bunch?
So then yeah, you got
so
the
Tom
better.
Brady came around. You know, they're like, you related to Tom? Oh yeah, that's cousin Tom. You know?
Yeah. And well, isn't his middle name Edward too?
It is. Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Like yeah, it's cousin Tom.
Still haven't
sure.
met him. That's definitely on the bucket list. Maybe you can have him on the show and introduce us.
I actually met him at Foxwoods once, and he was a dick.
Oh really?
He was, dude. He was like 4 o'clock in the morning, right? And me and my buddy Jimmy, he used to come up to Providence with me to see you. And we were playing blackjack, and he was playing blackjack at like a table that I'm not playing blackjack at. But we kind of stalked him out, and then when he was done, he might have just lost his ass, you know? But it was like 4 in the morning, so when he left his table, we left our table and casually walked his direction, and like, oh shit, Tom Brady, what's up, man? How you doing? And I was like, can we take a picture? And he's like, no, and he just kept walking.
Yeah, how old was he?
This was a while ago, man. This was might have been 12
like,
years ago.
Like pre-superstardom, or you think he's just popping off?
No, he was, I mean, he was definitely a star at that time. But I would say it was like maybe 2008, 2009.
Okay, yeah, he's definitely, yeah.
But like I said, he could have just lost his ass. But just,
yeah.
It wasn't like there was like a million people around hounding. It was just the two of us in the middle of the night, like, yo, what's up? And he's like, no, and just kept going. So.
Yeah, okay.
That's my Tom Brady story.
Hopefully you don't have any Ed Brady stories like that.
No, all my Ed Brady stories that I can remember are all solid, man. I mean, you did my old show on MySpace. You remember when I used to do the Shamrock
absolutely.
Show? But it was a completely different thing. But
yeah, man, it's great to watch the progression. You know, I've seen the episodes jump from 1,500 views, 2,500 views, you know, 5,000 views. Pretty cool. Like. You know, watching you do your thing, so
yeah, man, it's cool, and man, the feedback and the love is absolutely incredible. But a lot of that is just getting people who are interesting on, and you know, I've been lucky to have some guests who have some awesome stories. So, you know, some of them happy, some of them sad, but it's just, I think that there's just a lot of just regular people out there who have stories that are worth hearing. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? It's not necessarily have to be Tom Brady. It can be Ed Brady.
Yeah, that's what's up. Well, I'm humbled. I appreciate it. Thank you for the invite.
How was your weekend, buddy?
It was good, man. I ran into you on Friday night.
I know, which is great. Twice in 3 days or whatever, but up at CES MMA.
Great fights. Yep, they always put on a great production, CES MMA.
Yeah, I've been going to CES boxing since forever, and I love that they do MMA now. And,
absolutely.
Your man, Greg Rebello, with the big win, man.
Titus can be, man. One of my best friends. He retired for like the 70th time. You know, he's definitely Brett Favre in it. This might be the last, but I mean, it's tough to see him go out when he just dominated like that.
Right. He looked good. I was curious, you know, because he said, I'm not going to use the R word, but he said that it would be the last time to see. Yeah, so I didn't. You think he's just kicking around in case he gets the call from UFC or something? Or I mean,
it's tough.
I don't even know if that's something you can even talk about.
Yeah,
I know that have some inner workings, but
yeah, I mean, he's my guy. I mean, and for him to be there so close three times, he's been at you know, on the Dana White Contender
and
Series.
And just had shit luck, dude. I always see him on Twitter joking about he just has the worst luck in Vegas, man. You know,
absolutely. And you know, it's tough, man, because he's right there. He's certainly.
Well, I would say he's the best fighter ever to come out of New England. Dude, if he's
up there.
If he's not, he's in the top. You know, like Joe
obviously
Lowe's
Rob Font is a good.
He's
fighter.
Killing the game right now for sure. But you know, dude, Greg is a legend, and he's like he's such a good coach. He's got the mind too.
Well, that's it, man. The kid has a great heart, and you know, he's a great coach, and he's a great individual, and he gives back to the community, and so many people just. Even young up-and-coming fighters speak so highly of him.
Yeah.
So it's honestly just an honor to be his friend. So I'm glad I could be on the adventure with him.
Well, my buddy Brett.
I met him in Vegas, believe it or not.
Oh,
shit. Two guys from Rhode Island, and it was funny. We were at Vegas in a nightclub, at the nightclub and beverage expo.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was just like, just kind of started hitting it up, you know, chatting with him and stuff. Yeah. Didn't even know he was a fighter. And, like, I put a picture up or something, and my buddy from back home, Justin, was like,
yeah,
yo, you know that's Greg Ribello? Like, you just fought in the UFC? I'm like... Nah, but like he's mad cool, and like we've been tight ever since. So.
Oh, that's funny, man. I figured that you met. I figured you were like sponsored him or something, and that's how you guys met. But that's even crazy.
Yeah,
man.
It's crazy, man. It's just you know, it's crazy how life works out, and you just meet someone like at that level, and you know, 10 years later we're like best buds. So
that's cool, man. Yeah, I met Greg through so. My boy Brennan Ward fights for Bellator. He did the show a couple episodes ago, and Greg is his head coach.
Yeah,
and he's
dealt
with Brennan for a long time, so that's how I met him going up to that city of Dong, not city of Dong, Triforce in Rhode Island. I met him going up there, and then at fights and stuff, of course, man. But you're kind of a renaissance man. You've kind of so you, I know Tyson manages Greg, but you're like. My impression from the outside is like you're kind of the E to Ari Gold in this.
Yeah, man. I mean, Tyson does a great job. He's great with all his fighters, and you know, I just like helping my friends. You know, obviously I've been fortunate enough over the years to expand my network and get to know a lot of people, and I have a lot of great people, like yourself, and throughout the world actually. That and anyone that I can help link up to good people. That's kind of.
Did you meet John Gotti that night?
I did, man.
That's interesting, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
It's like
Dana White tweeted him right before the fight, or tweeted.
Yeah, but
him
no, I mean his father, John. I'm sorry, John
Gotti
Jr.
I did. I got introduced to him through one of my uncle John. His son is actually a Hollywood producer, John Ryan.
Okay.
And they were, I couldn't believe I saw him there, and I was like, he was sitting right next to Gotti. I was like, what the heck?
Yeah.
Going on?
So the guy I introduced you to, Brian, the ball guy, that I said he's got those restaurants in Springfield, he's done a long. Time in jail. He was John and him were cellmates at some federal organized crime pretend, you know. And he did the show because he's going on a TV show now. But then he's like, yeah, you want to meet John? I'm like, yeah. Like, what do you? It's not
of course.
Like, loved your murders, bro.
Yeah, right.
You know,
no, iconic.
Absolutely iconic.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely iconic. But yeah, it was great to run into you that night, man. For sure.
Totally.
I love going up to Rhode Island. But we first met, the first time I met you, I'm not sure if you remember, was at Shrine. Tony introduced us
at
Shrine one night.
We had started the Industry Tuesdays, too. That was like...
Right, and I definitely want to hit that.
Yeah,
I know that you're the brainchild there, in the brain trust. But, Tony, because at the time I was managing a club in Connecticut, a strip club, for a guy who, the kind of guy from Rhode Island owns strip clubs in Connecticut, know what I mean? And he was like, yo, do you know this one, blah, blah, blah. But we got chatting that night. But you were college roommates with one of my, like, good friends, Nicoletto, at Bryant, right?
Yeah. Nick's the man. I'm, you know.
Nick is did you see Uncut Gems, the movie Uncut Gems?
I can't say that reminds me of Nick, or does it? You know,
well, as I walked out, I was like, well, this is what it's like to be Nick for a day.
Yeah, I think I was texting him right when I left the movie. I was like, yo, dude, I know you, this is your life, right?
Yeah,
no, but he's you know, I'm it's great to see you know, obviously we were young kids and we were having a lot of fun in the casino and stuff together back then. But Nick is, I'm really proud of him. He's working with a great company now and doing a lot in the real estate game. So
Nick's a hustler, man. He's going to make, you know, no matter what he does, he's going to make it. I have no doubt about it. But I like to break his balls.
Yeah, how could you not? Absolutely.
But getting just, yeah, it's whatever. But like, kind of want to work backwards. You're a councilman is your title now?
Yeah, I'm a city councilman in the city of Cranston.
And you own 6 restaurants?
I think I have 5.
5. Yeah. Okay. I was trying to count them in.
Yeah.
But when I met you, you were a club promoter, right? And
yeah,
like, I know a million people who try to do what you did, but you're the only one who I ever saw do it to the level that you did, on such a successful level. And even before I get into that, man, you used to take such good care of us, up like ridiculous care of us, man. And it was always so dope, man. I always appreciate it.
Yeah, man, I appreciate you. It's you know, it's crazy, man. You take care of good people and you meet good people, and I think it always comes back in life. And that's certainly part of, I think, the reason that, you know, when I was a promoter, a lot of people in that, the nightclub industry, like you were talking about with strip clubs, it's known for like drugs and alcohol, and
right,
you know, to take that to a level of business where we had top notch videos back in 2008, 2007, when Facebook was, you know, just coming out, and
right,
you know, do the photography at the clubs, and then bringing in talent from LA.
Right.
It totally was like we kind of hit around by storm for a little bit, and we were bringing in acts like Aoki and DJ AM before he passed, rest in peace.
Yeah.
And, you know, obviously, you know, just funneling talent after talent where, you know.
No, for sure. I mean, like, it was like one of my favorite nights there. You had a DJ called Rocktacon. I had a live drum kit with it.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've tried to reproduce that. Like, I've tried to introduce DJs to drummers and, like, yo, you guys should link up and do this. It would be so dope. But nobody wants to do it. But it was such a cool performance. I remember was that Holly Madison that night?
Yeah, man? That was fun, too. Yeah,
You did. You brought a lot of top-notch stuff. But
LMFAO, did you make it up that night?
Yep, absolutely. Yeah. And I didn't even know. Fun. They were just known for they did the Jersey Shore theme at that point. That's like basically all that anybody knew them for. That's all who I knew who they were for, and that's probably why it worked so well in Rhode Island, right?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
But now when I say you're a club promoter, why don't you kind of explain kind of how, what it was you were doing at that time?
Yeah, of course. I think it would be impossible not to like kind of backtrack a little bit. I went to Bryant with Nick, and I graduated college, it was university then. And I moved out to L.A., and at the time, believe it or not, I was playing a little bit of professional poker that was big on the Bryant University scene.
Oh, see, I didn't know that. Yeah,
so
I have a sordid poker history as well.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah. I couldn't believe it when I told my parents that, you know, I had just won a tournament on an online site called Bodog, and I won like 20-something thousand. And after I just got my degree, I'm like, I'm moving out to Hollywood to be an actor and a poker player. And my parents were like, well, you know, you're not. And, but fortunately enough, they've always trusted me and they've loved me, and they knew I would follow my heart. So, you know, I moved out there for about a year and I started going to these clubs, and I linked up with my nephew, you know, John Ryan, my cousin, who was a Hollywood producer. He's done
great Irish name, by the way.
He's doing Bill and Ted 3.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so that's his recent project, and he's worked with you know, a lot of celebrities over the years. Who, fortunately enough, fast forward the story, when I moved back from LA after about 2 years of living out there, I had made contacts with a lot of these guys. So I literally just had no interest in doing that whatsoever. And kind of on a bet, I did a Wednesday night at a club called the Halo Room with some buddies.
Okay.
And literally it was in Cranston, and it just kind of like popped off, where we were doing like 150 people on a Wednesday, like list only, VIP service. And back then bottle service was legal in Rhode Island. I know it's still legal here. But that kind of just, the people in Providence noticed, and, you know, I had a camera and I was taking pictures at these nightclubs for free, and people were uploading them, and I started a website called 401, and obviously the rest is kind of just history, man. It was just hard work. It was funny, though, to watch my friends from college be like, what is this kid doing? Like, he just left, you know, they're all working at Fortune 500 jobs and whatnot. And companies, and here am I, I'm throwing parties with, you know, Bam Margera and Nick Cannon, and you know, they thought it was a lot of fun, but to an extent, they were like, okay, kind of grow up, Ed.
Right.
But, you know, I knew what I was doing.
I feel like that's how people look at me now, too, so it's whatever.
You know what, man? As long as you're happy and you have a vision and you know what you believe in, and it's a process, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of the generation now today, in my opinion, they want it right now, you know? Yeah. And it's like, it took me 8 years of club promoting for an investor finally to come up to me and say, hey, if you're ever interested in your own place, you know, let me know, you know.
Oh, that's kind of dope. So I was curious on how that all went. So, like, when you were doing these, like, promoting clubs, right? So, like, let's say I went to View or Water Place or whatever it ended up being, and you had, you know, a celebrity there. You were buying the talent and then getting the doors or something like that?
So how promoting worked out is initially I would, you know, I knew by taking pictures for free and uploading these pictures, I did that for a couple months, not even getting paid, literally just to establish a name for our website. And then we went after clubs that weren't doing that well. We asked them for the door. Yeah. We had to pay the talent. We had to pay a portion of the security. Okay. And then we also got a percentage back of the VIP when we were. And the deal got better and better, obviously.
Right, right.
But, you know, towards the tail end of that, we were getting 15, 20% of the VIP. We were also getting the door, and we had to pay the expenses.
Right.
So in Rhode Island, you know, it's tough to get people to pay $10.
Right.
So imagine that in 2009, 2010, 2011, right after, you know, the mortgage crisis and times are tough, we're now getting people to pay $30, $40, $50 to party with the Stevie Aokis of the world and party with celebrities.
Right.
And we're doing, you know, $15, $20, $25, $35,000 at the door. I mean, at the VIPs plus the door money. It was a crazy chapter, man. It was a lot of fun.
That's dope. Like, so how did you get a bar to agree to let you do that? Because, like, I mean, my place does really well, so I, like, people ask me all the time, like, you know, beat it. But, like, just somebody is like, hey, you're struggling, or I think you're struggling. Like, how do you tactfully say that and get them to buy into what you're doing?
Yeah, I mean, like anything else, clubs are hot for a few years, right? A lot of the club, you know, I owned a club myself, you know, 2-3 years. Like, perfect example is Shrine. I remember we were making a name for ourselves in Rhode Island. We were Vinny Vibe and myself, who I'm very proud of, has done a tremendous job with his branding and is now traveling the world. He was one of my original partners in 401. We approached Ryan. We said, hey, you know, we want to do a Tuesday night industry night. And they said, come back to us in 6 months. Come back to us in a year.
Yeah.
And to their credit, they were right. They knew they were going to be hot right off the bat. But, you know, after a year, they need some assistance. So we presented them the idea of doing a Tuesday night, industry New Year's Eve party. And I think that was our first party, and we got like 6 or 7 people. And
what year was that?
That was probably around 2009, 2010, 2011. Yeah. I can't even that range. But you know, I can even say just the amount that I've learned from Randy Greenstein, who's one of the owners of that group, and just the interactions that I have with him certainly have helped transcend me into, you know, the business career that I have today.
Right, and so, you know, being a Connecticut guy, Tuesdays at Shrine are a massive night. I mean, they do better on Tuesdays than they do Fridays. So and you were like the mason that laid the groundwork on that, right?
Yeah, I mean, fortunately, we had a beautiful venue and a great staff and a great management team, and they had everything to make that night, help make that night successful.
Right, right.
But it was great to bring the industry crowd up from Rhode Island and introduce them to kind of the Massachusetts market.
And like I said, your boy Vinny over there is killing. Like, I remember you had this, the first time I ever met Vinny was you had this Monday night spot, Forbidden City, on Federal Hill. And I used to love going up there on a Monday, man. It was just something cool to do. And Vinny was like this little kid with a frohawk
and
no beard. Everyone knows like his logo with the no beard and Hardy shirt. You know,
it was
fun, man. You know, but it's just like to see that, I was like, well, I mean, I remember that kid. And like, he's like, you know, online sees and he's here, he's there, he's playing.
Traveling the world,
huge,
getting thousands and thousands of dollars to DJ. But you know what? It didn't happen overnight. And I remember him making stickers and starting his branding and learning Photoshop and putting in the hard work. And here we are 15, 20 years later. And you know, he's really known in New England. And I can't say I'm really proud of the work and the time that he put in and the passion for his craft and his success.
What's the worst celebrity you ever worked with?
Oh man, that's a tough question. I hate talking badly about people.
All right, so even without saying their name, like whether it was an athlete, actor, kind of thing, and like you ever have something just go bad when you were doing an event?
You know, some of these riders. So you obviously have to deal with celebrity riders when you're working with celebrities, and some of them are crazy, and then you know some of them.
When you say rider, what do you mean?
So like they'll give you in the contract, there's certain things you got to provide in a dressing room for them, or certain type of hotel transportation, or a certain type of. So, you know, to be candid, someone like, Steve Aoki, we booked 3 times, I believe, in Rhode Island, $5,500, $6,000.
Right.
We got him right at the ground level of now he's probably $100,000 plus to book. But he was one of the best celebrities to work with. We played poker in my apartment. You know, we went to local clothing stores. He was just starting a clothing company called Dimmock. Yeah. We literally walked the streets.
You know what Dimmock is, dude? That's a death touch. For remember, you ever see Bloodsport?
Yeah,
you
know,
Van Damme comes in and they make him break the brick. Like, they're like, pick a brick. And the guy picks him at the top. And then like, the old Asian guy's like, no, bottom one. And he just breaks the, that's the Dimmock.
Oh, my God. I never asked him. That's incredible.
Yeah.
So I can say, I know you asked me who the worst is. I do definitively remember one of those riders.
Yeah.
The guy was just impossible. And he like wouldn't start his set until that rider was fully provided. We're talking about like minuscule things like all certain color M&Ms. Like, I wasn't even sure if he was, like, busting. And then, like, you know, it's like we're, like, a half an hour past set time, and I'm like, I guess this guy's not busting. So I got three people running around to, like,
make sure all the M&Ms are red or something.
Like, make sure he has, like, four towels specifically. Like, it was just insane. And he wasn't, like, similar to your situation. You know, it's tough hearing you talk about Tom Brady as one of my idols in here that you didn't have a good experience with him. This is someone that's pretty still in the public spotlight, and you know, he wouldn't even take pictures with people. I mean, when you're paying that kind of money, I don't know, you always have a vision of someone, and then when it's not that vision that you expect it to be, but you can learn from that. You can always learn from that. I mean, I take pride, and I was raised by a family that have always taught me to treat people with kindness and respect, and try to go the extra mile with people that you like. And I think that's you know, that's for anyone to learn, that, you know, networking and growing that groundwork and meeting as many people as you can by being kind can help get you where you are.
Yeah. Well, between working, so I did, like, out of high school, one of my first jobs was working at Fox. I was there for 5 years. And then between, like, working there and just being in the casino, you know, like, because when you grow up here, man, going to the casino is just, like, so just, like, a regular thing. You know, it's part of our life living in Connecticut, you know. As much as it is, I'm sure, like, living in Rhode Island, but, like, living 5 minutes from Mohegan, it's just, like, such a regular thing. And, you know, I've had a million different experiences with celebrities, but, like, luckily I've met Shaq twice and Connor 3 or 4 times, and all great experiences. Like, luckily my guys, like, luckily had great experiences with, because they would hate to meet, like, your hero and just have them, like, shit on you. Right?
Yeah, of course. And I'll tell you, before he passed away, DJM was, I mean, he was just a lovable guy.
What a legend, though, dude.
Yeah, it was just a legend. It was an honor to just even, I remember we booked him for $17,500. And to us, we, you know, that was a risk in Rhode Island.
Yeah, for sure.
And we sold out every VIP. We were charging $60-$80 to get in.
Yeah.
And ironically, we had booked him right.
What club did you have him at?
We had him at Monet.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, he was a great guy. We actually hung out with him when we went back out. It was funny. I lived in LA, like I told you.
Yeah.
When I graduated college, chasing that dream, and we had met these guys and whatnot, and It's crazy when you hear about people and then you're just kind of partying with them on a Tuesday night in LA, and they're just normal, just like anyone else. Right. You know, like, you put them at this pedestal, but then
they're just a guy or a girl or whatever. They're just people, man.
And to be on that level and fortunately enough be able to meet a lot of these people like that, living out there, in networking and kind of using that Rhode Island mentality of where everyone knows everyone and everyone's afraid to talk to everybody. LA was tough, man. It was like people were so afraid. We were just the Rhode Island guys that came in and just talked to everyone and were friendly.
I think that's like a whole New England thing. Like, you know, especially like hustlers from New England. Like, I got my buddy Tony moved to Myrtle Beach and he's just killing the game. Like, you get a New England person who was like a shark and you can go to wherever and I think you can make it, man, just based on how we grow up out here and just like we're all mean from dealing with the seasons, but like also like super happy when it's nice. And I think that, you know, just when you think of it, like, whether you're thinking of, like, mob stuff or, like, what you think of, like, hustling, you think of the Northeast, man. You think of New York, the city that never sleeps, you know, like, Boston.
Absolutely.
And, like, we have so much in such a locale where it's not, like, if you're L.A. is, like, L.A. and then San Francisco is 9 hours away. It's
totally.
Just, you know, there's so much going on, so much culture. You know, when I talk to my cousins in Ireland, I'm like, yo, if you come over, they're like, well, we want to see Boston or we want to see New York. Like, dude, we can do one day and one the next. It's just, it's here and it's here. It's not a big deal. You know?
No, it's awesome. I love living over here.
Man, I really, really loved Water Place. It was one of my favorite times when you were there. And there was a really cool crew there. I see Brandon is like the director of beverage at Foxwoods now.
Yeah, so proud of him, man.
Yeah, I've talked to him about coming on the show and he's with it. It's just not something worked out yet. But that's like a big job that he's got there, and that's pretty dope, man.
Yeah, that was a great chapter, man. Brandon was one of the ones recruited me to promote there, And he had previously worked at Monet, which is another club we were promoting at.
I remember Monet.
And, you know, I fell in love with the owner, a guy named Steve Mara. He was a...
What a good dude. I wasn't sure if I should bring that up.
No, of course, man. Yeah.
What a good dude he
was. Yeah, I have a lot of great memories. You know, Steve Mara, unfortunately, passed away. He committed suicide. And if he hadn't, I don't know if I ever would have left. I can tell you I don't think I ever would have left. I mean, he treated me so well. I learned so many lessons. I mean, he was just someone that was constantly in the public eye, smiling, giving back to the community, making sure that you know business and philanthropy went hand in hand. I mean, he was just known as one of the most generously kind-hearted people. And we did something special there. I mean, we had a great group with Brandon, promoting partner Jess Simone, and a lot of the guys. Don Parson, Shane Pichet.
Shane,
we had a great crew, and it's great to see even now, a decade later, people like Brandon be uber successful. And Don Parsons, ironically, worked security for me when he first started at, you know, $15, $20 an hour, and now he owns one of the most prestigious Rhode Island-based real estate companies called Anytime Realty, where, you know, my fiance works for me. He's got 25, 30 agents out of room.
Yeah.
You know, so, and that all started from the Water Place party, and we brought a lot of celebrities. We brought a restaurant that, you know, was doing okay to 800 to 1,000 people every weekend for 3-4 years.
Right. And, I mean, we would come up winter, summer, whatever. We would make, you know, the trek up from Connecticut, and like I said, dude, you took such good care of us. Where, so I was managing strip clubs at the time. So to me, my friends come to the strip club, like, oh, yeah, don't pay a cover. But, like, that was, like, your whole deal. And you would be like, nah, these guys aren't paying cover. You'd get us bottles for $100 or something stupid like that. Like, where you were just – the whole point of what you were doing, you were sacrificing for us to come up and have a good night. And you just always introduced us to everybody and made some cool connections there. So, like, you know, I ran into Steve at Patty's one day, and we partied, like, and it was with Gino. Remember Gino?
Yeah, of course. He passed away too. Yeah.
But we had it was like me and one of my boys and Steve and Gino, dude, just wiling on the beach. Gino telling everyone he was Pauly D's dad, and like all these like young hot girls hanging all over Gino, thinking he was Pauly D's dad. It was the funniest fucking thing, man.
Believable.
But one night up there at Water Place, some guys were giving Steve a hard time, and my boy Jimmy happened to be walking by and kind of got in the middle of it. And then, like, after that, like you introduced us to him, but Steve, like, always, all the Connecticut guys always looked out for us, man. So I always appreciated that, because being in this business now, there's a few guys who I like, try to emulate what they do, and you're definitely one of them, man. You're definitely – I look at how you treat people, the way you're creative. Like, I have a – So my bar is seasonal, and we close at the end of the season. So I do a going back to school. I do what I call a yearbook party, right, where we give out a bunch of white shirts and everyone signs like a yearbook.
Yeah, yeah.
But I did grab that from Forbidden City, where you did a party similar. It wasn't a yearbook party, but it was just like a
white
t-shirt.
Yeah,
like
I remember that.
Color,
yeah.
Like, so.
Well, that's really humbling, man. I really appreciate that. That means a lot, and I appreciate that. And same thing. I mean, Steve. I learned a lot from, and I think, you know, you have to continue to learn and surround yourself with good people and learn every day.
Yeah.
And no, that's really humbling. But that was an amazing chapter. I miss him every day, and you know, I'm glad that I did get to spend the time that I did with him in life and learn as much as I could from him. And we have a lot of great memories. 2 weeks before he passed, it was just me and him in Miami together on vacation.
Yeah.
And the one thing that I can say, because I know a lot of people in this world have been through this, is I didn't see it, and I still don't see it. So, I mean, just, you know that sometimes even the happiest people in the world are going through something, and everyone is going through something. So just, you know, always reach out there to people and make sure that they know that you're there for them.
Yeah, and I think right now that hits kind of hard, like, on, like, get way off subject, but this Kobe Bryant thing, man.
Tragic,
awful,
man.
You know, and it's got to be the biggest celebrity death of my lifetime or my generation I can think of. You know, I know a lot of different big celebrities have died, but a lot of them were overdoses or they were older. And it's like, dude, this was a young guy, youngish guy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And he dies in a helicopter accident with his daughter. So, like, whether even if you're not a basketball fan, man, how can you not say, like, I think everyone is, like, devastated by this
Absolutely.
Kobe Bryant thing.
Absolutely.
It's been kind of interesting to see unfold online people's reactions to it, but mostly very positive.
It's tough. It's tough with media too, like reporting before you even know.
Yeah, see that's tough. But if I own TMZ, I also get that's I'm sure they make huge money by being the ones that break that story. You know,
I'm
not saying it's right. I'm just saying I get it.
I mean, grown men crying. I mean, literally the world is in mourning right now just because, like you said, I mean, I remember Princess Diana passing. We were really young when that happened. But this is something that hits home to everyone because we all, you know, I posted the other day, you know, what a role model, and I'm so sorry to hear about all the families that passed. And, you know, I had one person comment, role model, ? I mean, this person, I mean, I don't know how you can't say he wasn't a role model.
Right.
You know?
So I kind of think I get what you're getting at, and I actually – I don't know the right answer. So 17 years ago, he was accused of a sexual assault.
Mm-hmm.
It never went to court. I don't know what happened. I wasn't there. I just don't know that when a guy dies that you necessarily have to bring up the worst thing that ever he was accused of in his life 17 years ago and never accused of.
Totally agree.
So it's not like it was the only thing he was known for. It's not
like you said, the story could come out, you know, not the day of his death, not the week of his death.
Right.
I think that,
you know, if you're doing a biopic on him, like if you're doing a documentary of his life story, that has to be in there. It absolutely does. But when you're just, he died tragically like that day, I don't think that's something you necessarily, and I could be wrong. I'm just saying that my viewpoint on it is I don't know that it's necessarily relevant. And also the justification, but like a lot of people who I saw posting that kind of stuff were like the kind of people who are like, look at me. It's like, how can I use this for like attention on me, which is the toxic side of social media. But, you know, social media business-wise is so important, but there's a very toxic side to social media.
I absolutely agree. I don't think you could go back for 15 years of my posts and we're friends. I don't think I've ever posted anything negative.
Right.
And I'll delete anything that is negative. It's just not, but you're absolutely right. There's a lot of people on there that are always commenting on this or commenting on that. And it's very hard to see. But I agree with you.
You know, and that actually makes me think too. So 2009, 2010, 11, whenever I was going to your clubs in Rhode Island, if I had Facebook, it was barely anything. I had MySpace. But, like, how as a promoter did you spread the word? Social media definitely wasn't the primary engine of spreading the word at that point. How did you get your brand? So, I mean, I remember going to 401.com to go see the pictures and stuff that you took. And I think that maybe that built a lot of loyalty that people, because people knew where they'd go see their pictures, because people weren't posting a bunch of pictures on Facebook and they weren't posting as many pictures on MySpace. But what was your marketing technique at that point?
Back then, learning at Bryant was learning a lot about networking and obviously creative partnerships. So the benefit of, like I said, what we did then before MySpace and Facebook were really popular is we made sure that we were going out and hitting up every single valet, and we were giving them reduced admission passes. So if the passes would come back, we would then hit those valet back with $2. And we're saying we would go to the strip clubs and we would make sure that we would get in the doorman when people were leaving, give them that, and go back and hit them up with money. We had creative partnerships at the hotels. We had them literally everywhere. But on top of that, we also were very aware of what other shows were going on in town. If we could do the after party, we were making sure that we were messaging people about their birthdays and utilizing Facebook and MySpace, not necessarily for the marketing aspect of things, but now we know when everyone's birthday is, right?
Right.
So you can hit them up and give them a free bottle of champagne if they bring in six of their friends.
Yeah.
If you're targeting just women, obviously you know that women that time brought in men. And like you kind of said, we kind of took it to a next level, which is really great to hear and very humbling. I mean, we would spend the extra money, and we knew that it wasn't about the short-term monetary gain. It was the long game, right? So even though we were spending a little bit more on flyers and spending a little bit more on video and spending a little bit more on creating, you know, a better party and better everything and making sure that people left feeling upscale, feeling good, feeling and wanted to come back, it's because we could, you know, we knew that if we were comping friends and whatnot, that they would support us on those $40, $50 nights when we had the big talent.
Right.
And that's, that's when we made our money. That chapter was business 101. I learned so much. We left a lot on the table. But we also, you know, we gained a lot of relationships that we still have today in this life and through those memories.
Right. I mean, the legwork that you're talking about is so impressive and so important. And why you're successful. Like, now you'll see somebody post and tag 100 people, and they're like, oh, yeah, I promoted the event, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's to hear that kind of legwork that went into that, man, and the relationships you had to build is not only impressive, but anyone who's out there who's thinking of doing anything in, I would say, the hospitality business, but really any business, man, that's the kind of thing to go out and do, is to meet the people who are meeting people. Like you said, valets, bouncers, things like that, people who are going to be in the line of fire of your customer, you know. Yeah. I think that's really what you'd want to get at.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. And I think even now in the restaurants today, what brings people back, right? It's obviously taking care of people, making sure that their birthday is that much more special, their anniversary, their shower, whatever it may be. But it's great food and over-the-top service. So that's what I continue to stress to our staff and our management team. And, leave your bad days. We all have bad days, you know. Leave it at home. You're there to make take money. Care of the people that are coming in and spending their hard-earned dollars on a time away from home.
Hey, what's up, man? This is Sean at the Shamrock Show. Sorry for the little break in the action, but we got to keep the lights on. We got to shout out my boy Scott Camassar from the law offices of Scott Camassar and Stephen Reck, personal injury lawyers. If you ever get hurt, you need a qualified attorney. You got to know what your rights are, what your options are. These guys are personable. They'll take care of you. They care about the outcome, and they'll make sure that you're taken care of for your losses, whether it's a motor vehicle, wrongful death, injury, slip and fall. They even got somebody who was scammed when buying a dog through a breeder who took advantage of them. So whatever you got going on, just make sure that you have a qualified and competent attorney. Scott Camassar and Stephen Reck will make sure that you get taken care of. Thanks.
So you said you worked as a promoter, you know, for yourself, but promoting 8 or 9 years, and then you had an investor come to you about opening a spot. Was Vanity your first spot?
It was. So I had met my investing partner and current business partner, Jeff Quinlan, when I was caddying at my first job at 13 years old. Okay. At a country club, and we had played hockey against each other, and we kept in touch throughout college, and he ended up starting coming to some of the club events and really kind of liked what we were doing and said, if you ever want to open up your own place, let me know. I said, I appreciate it. That's humbling. And he wasn't the only one. There were other people saying it, but a lot of people would say it behind deaf checkbooks.
They would just
I'll open up a place with you. And to be candid, if Steve didn't pass away, Jeff had approached me prior to Steve passing away. And then when he did, I kind of circled back, and I was kind of upset, and, I just knew everything wasn't going to be the same there, obviously, without him there. He was the magical touch. I said, hey, I don't know if you were serious, but, if you are serious, let's do this. And within a week, we had business plans going, and he wrote a check for a rather large amount of money. And he was a young kid hustling, and he just had graduated law school himself, and he was flipping real estate property, and it was a lot of money to invest in. I mean, we knew each other, we were friends, we grew up together, but I mean, when you've invested over six figures into someone else, it was kind of almost gut checking for me, because as successful as we were,
I don't want to lose this.
And that grind and that work ethic, I feel like I've always had since an early age. Just from hardworking parents that grew up not wealthy themselves. Never wanting to let them down for everything that they sacrificed for me. I think I've carried that over into our business relationship. And fortunately enough, Vanity was very successful, and I got to pay him back in under a year. And then so that was cool. I mean, nightclub business. But now here's the thing that happened then in nightclubs. So we had that for about 2 years, and it was, it was popping. We knew the club length. I know the life length of a club is 3-4 years, I said to you. Sometimes if you're spending $12 million plus dollars, around a little bit longer. But at least in that market, I knew that, or you'd have to rebrand after that. 2 years in, they eliminated bottle service in the state of Rhode Island.
Which is crazy.
So you go from doing $10,000 to $15,000 to $20,000 a night in VIP to nothing. So you obviously have to rebrand and redevelop your entire business model.
What have the nightclubs done to offset that, or have they, or they just kind of make do with is there any kind of backdoor thing to that, or is there
I certainly know that there are some clubs that are illegally still doing bottle service on occasion. Because I think that the regulation of it can be, when they first made it illegal, I mean, there were people coming in every other weekend checking to see if we were doing it,
tables and stuff,
fining us, and then if you did do it more than twice or three times, you literally could lose your license. Now it's kind of became like a backdoor, like no one the liquor board, from my knowledge, is at least not really regulating.
It's not priority for them right now.
Yeah. But that being said, if everyone started doing it again, yeah, they would regulate it again.
Right, right.
So, you know, that was tough. We you know, at that point, we had opened another restaurant and, you know, the Thirsty Beaver in Cranston, and that was going really well. But we realized that we had to begin the stages of rebranding that earlier than we had anticipated.
Right, which is now Milk Money.
Milk Money, yeah.
Awesome spot.
Thanks, man. Yeah, it's a blessing. We got a great crew, great executive chef, great management team, and a great cocktail program. Brunch is going excellent, and we're really blessed that we're almost 3.5 years into that, and it's.
And how long did you have Vanity for?
We had Vanity for about 3.5 years.
So you're still 7 years at the one location under two names. Yeah. That's, you know, that's
first,
deadly, man. I mean,
our first lease.
How many restaurants close after 1 year? Is it like 50% or something like that?
It's the first 2 years, definitely tough. Yeah. But yeah, it's going really good, and really blessed to have. I mean, it's just crazy to kind of even look at that, you know, how Jeff and I started, and we had our first location, and and now with the five, we have over 100 employees, and you know, it's kind of crazy because I feel like it happened like almost overnight, you know, and it's been 7 years.
Right. And overnight success, 20 years in the making.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, of course. Absolutely.
What have you seen in that time, you know, other than the bottle service? Like, what does the customer expect, or what does the customer expect differently? Like, so for me, what I've seen in the business here is people expecting, they want bottle service everywhere. They think every bar should just have bottle service, and they're looking for higher end entertainment and stuff. What are you seeing that in the customers' wants and needs that have changed over the from 2009 until 2020 that you've had to adapt to?
So, I mean, particularly with that law, because of that law, and I'm not sure if it's just in the Rhode Island market. When I go out, if I want to really go out, I'll go out to Boston or I'll go to Connecticut because they still offer that VIP experience.
Right.
But in Rhode Island, it almost seems like the 18 to 27 to the 30 year old demographic, they're completely content with karaoke bars and cheap drinks and you know, acoustic music or whatever it may be. So that was kind of one of the reasons we evolved from when bottle service became illegal to that hometown pub and grub brand. And obviously it's been very, very successful for us. But nightclub in Providence, I can tell you, unfortunately, is not what it used to be, and I would love to see it make a revival.
Yeah, well, it seems like, because I've gone out on in Rhode Island on a Friday or Saturday a few times. It's just not the same as it was. You know, I'm almost 40, and to me, a nightclub isn't like such. But like once in a while to go out, but it's like everywhere is just not like me and Sam are walking around like, damn, like you know, telling our friends who hadn't been there, like you should have seen this place. You know,
it's almost
like a mecca, man.
It's almost tough to believe. And there's some great brands now in Providence now that are still doing it pretty well.
The first club I ever went to in my life was in Providence. I was 16. And they had an all-ages night. It was called Confetti. Do you know Confetti?
Yeah, of course. Joe Aloisio is the owner of Confetti, right?
I don't know, man. I didn't know anybody. I was in Connecticut, but, like, I had a buddy who lived in Westerly, and he was a couple years older than me, and he had a car, and he's like, hey, we're going to go to this club. And my mother was like, are you going to get shot in Providence? Yeah. You know, like, terrified.
Was it then Pearl?
It was Confetti.
But that's what it evolved to, Pearl?
Pearl, yeah.
Yeah, so we promoted at Pearl.
Pearl, right. Yeah. Which was a huge difference from Confetti to... Is Pearl still there?
So now Pearl is Mezzo.
Okay.
And
Pearl was dope when that first opened, though, like all the crystals and stuff. That was like one of the coolest looking venues I've ever been to.
Joe has a great ability to readapt and change it, and he's kind of rebranded that location many, many times and found success.
So. Yeah, it's funny. Like, I look back. So that's where I first met your buddy, Justin Erickson. He was a bartender there.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's always been a cool guy to me. And then I remember seeing DJ Dirty Deck play there. You had him there one night. And now he's, like, a huge, killing it with BNEG. And he does artwork for them.
His art is insane, man. I bought one of – I still have one of his first unique pieces that he did for me. You know, never give it away. But I'm so proud of him too.
Yeah.
Just to see him as a Cranston cat that, you know, was literally DJing one of the first places that I went to as a drinking customer at 18, the grind, to see where he is today, traveling to Miami, traveling to Boston,
right,
and doing artwork everywhere. And that's another thing. It's funny. You know, Will Blackman said to me, played professional football for over a decade. He's one of the only Rhode Island guys, that played football. And I just went up to him at a party when I was 21 years old and I said, hey, I want to meet you, you know? Yeah. And we kind of just kept in touch over the years, and he's became a pretty good friend.
Yeah.
But he said to me, you know, a lot of people hated on you when you were doing your thing. And he's
I'm not surprised.
He said, I never hated on you. I saw you getting to know people and just talking and just being a genuine person. And I think that's kind of, you know, not a lesson to be learned, but it's like just everyone doesn't always have an angle, right?
Right.
If you just want to meet people and you want to connect people, you don't have to make a monetary gain just for always connecting people.
Right, right.
Eventually it always comes back without even thinking about that, you know? And that was a really nice thing for him to say. And
no, that's dope. And I remember it wasn't just you. There was a bunch of promoters in Providence at that time, like all trying to do what you did, but I, you know, and some of, you know, like Kelsey Mitchell is a homie, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Like,
she was awesome. She worked with us for a while.
But, you know, you saw a lot of people trying to do it, but it was like, well, you know, there's Coke and then there's a bunch of RC Colas, you know? And
yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
You were really killing it.
No, I appreciate it. And even, you know, some of the other promoters, even today, you know, the ones that worked really hard and like After Dark Promotions, Paul Carbone owns a brand called Innovation Fitness, which I continually support.
Yeah.
So it's, I mean, it's funny to see even the bartenders and the people from back then, you know, I'll try to go out of my way to support them from a decade ago because, you know, we kind of all grew up together. We all had a lot of fun together. We all learned together. We all mourned together.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's a tight-knit community that even though, you know, I might evolve into restaurants and politics and whatever it may be, I still am honored and very pleased to get their support also.
Do you see any young Bradys, Ed Bradys out there? Are there people out there doing the promotion thing for clubs these days or no?
You know, that's such a great question. You know, I think we just spoke on the part of, you know, where I wouldn't be afraid to go up to anybody and talk to anybody. You know, we've grown to over 100 employees, like I said, and I've only had two people ever ask me to sit down and have coffee or learn my story. And I don't know if that's fair or I don't know if it's just, you know, but those two people. And speaking, you know, little things go a long way. I mean, you know, I help now them grow, you know, and someone that just asked me how to, you know, can I have a minute of your time and just how do I improve to get to that next level?
Yeah.
Even something as simple as that goes a long way with me. So do I see a next, you know, I try to find people that I can surround myself with every day and grow them in my management team and grow them together with me. But it's tough, man. I don't know. Like my mom, when I was first starting caddying, 13, 14 years old, got diagnosed with breast cancer. And, you know, I don't know if that was just like a changing point for me because I was a class clown, funny kid, doing everything. I'm not saying that stopped it, but like that was like a gut check of reality of like, all right, I got to work hard. I got to support for my family because my father had already retired on disability, so she was the only one working in my family. So I took that first job. You know, I was taking my paycheck home, and I was, you know, I was trying to help out wherever I could. And fortunately enough, she's good today. But it was like I haven't stopped working since that day. A 70, 80-hour work week is like that's like the norm.
Regular, right?
You know, and it's so to hear kids say like, "Oh, I already worked 35." That's cool. You know, and if that's the life you want, but it's like I've always. You know, it was funny when I first started, it was like, it was about making the money and you know, working those hours to make the money. But it's as I started to get the money, it was less about making the money and more about making the difference. More about, you know, like you said, making a difference in people that, whether they work for me or special occasions or, and that's the purpose for me, you know, giving back to the community and making sure that, you know, we can feed as many people we can with these homeless dinners that we do or you know, just raise millions and millions of dollars for local nonprofits. That's what feels good, and that's what I think ultimately turns into a good life. I've seen a lot of people make a lot of money that have been miserable.
Right, right.
So it's about finding that balance and surrounding yourself with good people and finding love. And I'm not even really sure how we got on this topic, but it was a great question if you got me there with that answer.
Yeah,
so.
Man. Well, no, but this is what I'm interested in hearing, man, and I think this is what people would be interested to hear is just kind of that kind of mindset and that kind of thought process, you know, like I have waitresses that work for me where, you know, they'll come in and if it's slow and then it's busy and then it's slow again, they want to get cut. And I have waitresses who come in and it's slow and then it's busy and then they clean and they, oh, you know, like, can I draw something on the chalkboard? Can you teach me how to bartend? Like,
and who are you going to give that next money shift?
Right, man. So. You know, and even like, dude, I think I've said this on this podcast, but like the smallest thing is like people who hustle, you know, via, like, so it's like, you know, I'll grab a dishwasher who is like the most
entry level basic position in a restaurant, you know, you could be somebody who's a high school dropout or whatever, and you know, if they come in and I don't have to ask them, the garbage is out, man, their area is clean, there's always silverware for the waitresses, and they're not yelling at me, you got no fucking silverware, you know, like if you do that job, great, and then I'll get you to be a fry cook, and boom, I'll throw you another dollar an hour. Oh, you're hustling, you're killing it on fries, cool, and let me teach you the grill, and I can get you another dollar. Like, and, you know, if you do that, all of a sudden you go from making minimum wage and you make $15-16 an hour, and you know, if you have no education and like you're just looking, if you were looking for a dishwasher job and within a year I can get you to the next level, then you know what? Go apply at a chain restaurant and, you know, maybe before you know it, you'll be making $40,000-$50,000 a year as a restaurant manager at a Ruby Tuesdays or whatever. It's just if you can go out and get it, you know, it's there to be had, man. It's there to be had.
And there's so many people within our organization that started as bussers that are now, you know, bar managers or our general manager even. You can't train hard work, and then nothing beats hard work and people that are genuine and true.
Right.
You know, education is great, and I certainly am fortunate enough that, you know, my parents worked hard to allow me to get a college education and help me out by going to Bryant. But you know, that work ethic, you know, I've had interviews where it's been like, okay, 4.0 GPA, great college, and a kid that just, you could just tell genuinely wants it, and I went in that direction. I've never been more pleased going in that direction.
Right.
You might have to put a little bit more effort and love into that person
right. And
train them what they don't know. But you can't treat, you know, you can't, loyalty and hard work, I mean, those are some of the best things you want out of someone in the restaurant industry or in life.
Right, no, for sure. So we talked about vanity, which became Milk Money, right, which is dope. But you've actually started a brand. You have a chain. Would you call it a chain? Or what would you, I don't know what you would call it.
Yeah.
You have three locations of a place called the Thirsty Beaver, which, what a name.
Thanks, man.
What a name.
You always want to make something that's brandable, right? And we've been very fortunate with that brand. That was the idea of Jeff Quinlan, my partner, the name. And it was kind of cool just sitting down at the table with him and coming up with our first logo and making it cartoony and something that a bar that just a log cabin, family friendly, anybody would want to go. And even though the name might be kind of scary at first to some, the elephant in the room. But, you know, it's great seeing a two-year-old in there in a high chair, all the way from a senior citizen, just kind of anybody and everybody every 7 days a week.
Right. So you've got one in Cranston, which was the original one.
Yep, where we grew up with Justin's, one of our business partners there.
Yeah.
Who we spoke about earlier, who's, you know, obviously bartending all at the clubs we did.
Yeah.
Talk about loyalty and working hard.
Right, right.
You know, we knew that we wanted him to run a bar program, and he's kind of grown with us to be a partner with it. We also have one in Smithfield, which is the town I went to college at.
College, yeah.
Great market.
And the most recent one
is in Rentham, like, Foxborough line, yeah. It's right attached to Supercharge Entertainment, which has an indoor go-karting track, Ninja Warrior course. Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
Right by the stadium, right?
Yeah, very blessed. I mean, that's a great opportunity, and we were actually invited by the owner of Supercharge to be in that project.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So how did they find out about you?
Just kind of, you know, same thing, networking. He's a local renowned guy, Alpine Country Club guy, and the family had always been there, and Jeff and myself over the years just networking and doing our thing. They needed a strong restaurant operator, and they knew they were going to be doing high volumes with the go-karting, and they're doing some really high volumes. They're on 2-3 hour waits on Saturday nights. The Ninja Warrior course trampoline park upstairs is really, really fun. And you know, we think we're doing a pretty good job of complementing their brand. And $12-15 million project, certainly the highest, the biggest project to date for us to partner up with. And we're exciting where that, you know, the brand can go from here.
And then you have Huck's Filling Station?
Yeah, that's also.
I haven't been there yet.
So that's in that's right in the East Greenwich Warwick line, right off Main Street. Ironically, Steve Marr's headquarters is two buildings down, so it's certainly homage to him. But we took an old garage. It was an idea that we had, and kind of converted it into a fun. We recruited a chef from Ocean House, which is one of the most iconic places in Rhode Island, and it's going really good. Our partner Jared Millay there runs it. He's also a childhood friend that I moved out to Hollywood with.
So
that's the five that we got going right now. We also have a catering operation called Pink Pig, which I'm not really counting because it's not an actual physical space.
Okay, so that's not so. But that's where you had the donut shop, right? Is it operate out of that?
So the donut shop, we've tried two brands at that. We did Four Corners, and we did Pink Pig, and then we did Daisy Joe's Chicken.
Yeah.
So that was one of our failures. So all of our other brands are are going pretty well. But you know, that's kind of some great advice I like to talk about too. Everything's, as an entrepreneur, everything's not gonna
not a win.
Yeah, right. there's losses, and you got to learn quick and adapt and improve. And and that was definitely a loss, but we learned from it. And
now, with having three spots at that place that didn't work, do you think the location is key in that, or what as someone who's obviously a hitter, what was the strike there?
Yeah, market research is important. So one thing that we learned from there is traffic doesn't necessarily mean business. There's a lot of cars going by that area on a particular day,
yeah.
But it's very hard to get in because the traffic, for the most part, is going the other way, going south towards the airport. So you know, people were just, they didn't want to wait particular long length of time to get into that location.
To make the turn into the spot.
And, you know, we've had locations at, you know, the Thirsty Beaver Cranston was a tough location prior to us being the Thirsty Beaver Cranston.
Yeah.
And some of the other locations that we take, we're kind of, not naive, but we believe that we can, just like when I was a promoter, rebrand a concept, bring a strong brand there,
and
maybe overcome the obstacles that, in that particular location, we just couldn't, you know.
I've got a project like that myself. I'll tell you at dinner later today. But, yeah, you know, sometimes you just got to believe that you can do it.
Yeah,
know,
of right? course.
Because if you don't believe you can do it, then
absolutely.
Right, why is anybody else going to believe in you?
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, and an important part is you know, like I said, entrepreneurs are going to fail.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to happen. We're the, you know, you just got to make sure you learn as much as you can from it.
Well, from 2005 to 2007, I owned a bar, and I had never even worked in a bar before. And a situation came up where me and my buddy, we got it for free because the guy who owned it died, and his son was just like, just pay rent, and, you know, it was good to go. And we were really good. We had been known in the area for throwing hotel parties. We would throw ragers. We were banned from every hotel in the area.
Yeah.
But we would pack the party. So I was like, oh, dude, I can pack this place. But I didn't know about business, you know.
Yeah.
So to me, like, that was like a little college to me, where it was like, you know, the bar made $3,000, and I said, oh, I made $3,000, and then the cooler broke and I can't even fix it, you know what I mean. But that's just, to me, my failure in that place is like one of the most important things that's ever happened to me, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
Without question.
And one of the biggest things I can contribute to our success is surrounding myself with people that are good at things that I'm not, or good at specific areas of
right,
business
yeah,
that
no,
I'm not, you know,
yes.
and you know, like you, like I was really good at, with, you know, and I like to believe that I'm still really good with people
yeah.
and being the face of a business, but, you know, my partners behind the scene are great at beverage costs and making sure labor costs are hit, and, you know, making sure your payroll, you
right.
know, numbers are intact, and I think that's, you know, I think what's, you know, obviously 100% of zero is zero, right?
Right.
You know, 30%, 40%, 50% of a large market. Don't be afraid to, you know, surround yourself with people. That's advice I'd give to those going into business, and with people that know what they're doing that you're not necessarily strength of yours.
Right, because you'll talk about someone, they don't know what they don't know. You know
yeah,
what I mean? Like,
course.
If you know what you don't know, but you can recognize talent in people who can fill those gaps, that's like being a general, man. That's like
absolutely.
That's what's super key.
And I see a lot of people not willing to take critique or objectively look at themselves. I will look at myself objectively on a daily basis and understand, okay, I could have handled that better, or I could do this better.
Yeah.
And I think that's crucially important in any entrepreneur's success, is always be evolving, always be learning, always be, you know, you got to go with your gut, obviously.
Yeah.
But, you know, you can never stop learning.
And now you're a politician.
Yeah.
So in life, politics or something.
Promoter to politician.
Oh, it's all the same as people, right? You're
yeah,
dealing
absolutely.
With people and getting people to like you. But
yeah.
when it comes to politics, I'm kind of ignorant. Like, I pay attention to issues, but as far as, like, I can't tell you what a selectman versus a mayor, like, I have no idea. So you're a counselor, and I have no idea what that means.
Yeah, so in the city of Cranston, there's nine city councilmen. There's three citywide councilors, and then there's six wards. We kind of obviously go over the budget and go over you know, safety services and ordinance and finance and public works and different areas of the city. We help balance the budget with the mayor, and we work hand in hand.
Yeah.
Right now we have a 5-4 Republican to Democratic majority on our council.
Yeah. And you're what?
Well, that's the funny thing. So I grew up in a very Democratic household.
Yeah.
Prior to being a councilman, I was an independent.
Yeah.
And it was a Republican seat the mayor had asked me to fill. And I was honest with him. I looked him in the eye and said, to be honest with you, I'm a business person. You know, I lean a little bit fiscally Republican.
Yeah.
But, you know, I also have a lot of policies in life the way I grew up to be Democratic. And he said, you know what, Ed, I know who you are. I know the man that you are in the community. Yeah. It, you know, even, you know, I would ask you to be a Republican for this particular seat, but I know that that doesn't matter. And you don't see that a lot in politics. It's like so many people are Republican, right. Democrat. And you know,
I hope that that changes as it goes forward, because I feel like younger people in our generation and younger don't. Like, I couldn't possibly identify, because there's some, you know, issues that are Republican that, like, are, like, right, and I'm like, yo, I'm right there with them. There's some that are left, and I'm like, yo, I'm like, yeah, I could never possibly identify with a party, because, like, on certain issues that are key to those parties, like, I either agree or disagree with, you know what yeah. I mean? So, you know, I think that hopefully that opens, that thought process opens up more.
I'll tell you, I mean, it's not, we're not dealing with, you know, nationwide issues and even statewide issues to that extent. We're dealing with city and yeah. what's best for the kids and what's best for the community. Yeah. And what I can say is I heard a lot of horror stories about politics and, you know, Democrats and Republicans just not being able to get on the same page and get a lot done locally. We're very fortunate. We got a great council. We get a great group of people. A lot of the votes are going 9-0. We're all on the same page, whether it's Democrat or Republican, even though we have the majority, just to make a difference for our local community. So I'm going to continue to – I'm going to run for re-election.
Yeah.
As long as I can continue to balance it.
Right. So how much of your time does that take?
It's funny. You know, like I said, I'm definitely still putting in the 70, 80 hours a week in the business. And I'm putting in 20-plus hours a week in the politics. So, I mean, it's constant. The schedule is –
Do people use that against you in running? The reason I ask, so the local of this town, first selectman, this guy Mark, he plays in a band that I have at my bar. But he also owns a bunch of Geico offices. Mm-hmm. In the last election, I saw his opponent was like, how can this guy possibly be good for the city when he's got these businesses to run?
I think when I first started, you know, there were certainly people that were saying that. Mm-hmm. But I think now I think they're saying it a little differently, because they're seeing, you know, the work that I'm putting in, and time of day is not, you know, my phone's always on and I'm receptive and I get back to people. And I think the knowledge that I've gained in business and I'm using in politics. And I'd like to believe that I'm going to get reelected and that I'm pretty well liked in that area. You just never know. Politics is scary. I was sitting at the polls at, you know, 8:10, you know, when the polls close at 8 o'clock, not sure if I'm going to win. And it's a really humbling place to put yourself in. And fortunately, you know, I won. And we'll see where it goes. But as long as I, you know, you put the bull crap aside with the politics and you continue to do what's right for the people. And as long as I can continue to believe that I'm making a difference in the community, I'm going to continue to put myself out there and do it.
That's dope, man. So, like, what are the key issues that are important to you right now that you deal with? Like, not necessarily stuff that's, like, out of your hands, but stuff that you actually, whether it's something you can physically do something about or at least are in the conversation
yeah,
with, what are the key issues?
I mean,
issues?
Fiscal responsibility is huge.
Of
I mean,
the city?
Yeah, I mean, you're dealing with a budget of, you know, $300 million. I mean, education is obviously is always on the forefront of my mind. You know, there's a lot of schools in our area, at least, that need to be updated. So there's a bond that's going to be going to vote. So I'm interested for over $100 million, but we might be able to get 70% of that back from on the state level. So we'd really only be investing $30 million. If we can efficiently prove that we can do that in a timeline of 5 years with construction and do it right, then it would be a fiscally sound project potentially for the city.
Yeah.
But, you know, solar farms have been a big issue in our area because green energy is obviously crucially important, but we also have to protect the character of our community and residents' home values that are for nearby values. They were building 30-plus acre farms, and basically no one had a right or a say based on how it was zoned for their neighbors. So we just eliminated solar farms in A80, which is residential areas in Cranston. Honestly, and it's just being receptive to the phone calls of people that didn't feel like the city's against them. And I had a guy at one of our last meetings kind of who was a strong Democrat look me in the eye with tears in his eye and say, you've changed my view of politics. You know, I felt like no one was listening to me and,
that's
you know,
dope.
You've been wicked receptive. And that's, you know, it's the time that it takes away from my fiance and my family and my business even. Because it's not a high paying job, at least on the council level. It's we make, you know, $5,000-$6,000. People think we make a lot more in benefits and all that to be putting the time in that we do. But honestly, I just genuinely do it because I care about the city of Cranston. I love Cranston. I'll be there the rest of my life. I'm not going anywhere.
Yeah.
It's my hometown. I'm proud. you know, my parents, like I said, worked really hard to get me there, and I'm never going to leave. So,
what's your goals in politics, man? Like, is there an Ed Brady presidential run in 20 years?
I don't know, man.
Is that like something that would, like, in your wildest dreams be in there, or you're just like, nah, it's not like,
you know, it's, I never, you just never know where life's gonna take you. I never thought I'd be in politics to begin with, right? Yeah. So, you know, like I said, being a promoter to a business owner to an entrepreneur, I was fortunate enough, the mayor asked me to fill a seat that became open. Who knows where it's gonna take me? You know, I'd like to believe, as long as I continue to follow my heart and I enjoy it. See, here's the big X factor. I'm getting married in June to a beautiful fiance. I don't have kids. I've been able to manage all this prior to having kids, and I do want kids. So, you know, I just have to make sure I continue to surround myself with great people that can, you know, because business is obviously priority.
Right.
City, I have to be able to manage with it at the same time, and family. As it's growing, it's going to get tough. So,
and I'll say this for you, even though I know you're already thinking it. What a gem your fiance must be to put up with the amount of time that you have to dedicate. So I've got one bar that's seasonal and then another project in the works, and my girlfriend has to make serious sacrifice for the amount of time. So with what you've got going on, clearly,
I'm blessed. She, you know what, we met at the bar. We met at the Beaver, and you know, she became, honestly, a very good friend. She was giving me advice on girls, and I was giving her advice on guys, and we were just kind of kicking it for like 2 years.
Yeah.
And you know, so she knew the amount of work and time that I put into it. So to meet someone on a friend level like that and keep all that other crap, I was always attracted to her. I mean, there's no way I couldn't be. But
right, for sure.
You know.
Good for you.
Yeah, and then I mean, here we are today. So I'm it's a lot of hours and it's a lot of time, but you know, she believes in me. And it's important to surround yourself with that, obviously, with loyal, caring people that believe in you.
Right.
And, you know, I hope she'll always be in my corner, but she's certainly in it now. So
that's dope, man. Before we get out of here, I just want to touch on a couple things. Like, so you lived in L.A. and you did some acting, and then some of that's come back. Like, you were involved in The Brotherhood, which I loved. It just didn't hit, but a show in Providence. You did a little acting, right?
Yeah, I did a little acting. Acting was fun. It's funny that you bring up Brotherhood, because I was like... So I was in, you know, I was in like small things like Mad TV with like a John Cena sketch and 27 Dresses, and you know, I was like an extra in Entourage, and we were doing like a whole bunch of fun stuff back then.
I didn't know you were an extra in Entourage.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. I'll have to show you that clip.
Yeah.
But you know, Brotherhood. So that's the furthest I had ever made it. It was for a reoccurring role, and you know, I had already auditioned and sent in my videotape. And I had done everything, and I had literally two lines, and it was, "Hey, you want to lower your voice? The mooks from Connecticut gonna hear you." And
then I slide. Yeah, I remember you telling us that at one point. Yeah.
So then I slide over the money. I say, "It's what Johnny told me to give you. If you got a problem, you talk to him, right?" So so now I'm with the cast. I'm in the screen test. I'm with the actual actors, and those are my two lines. I can remember them to this day, right?
Yeah.
So then I say the line. I say, "Hey, you want to lower your voice? The fucking," and I drop the F bomb, and I'm not even much of a swearer, but I just thought it was impactful to the line. I was reading a different way, and the director goes, good, but can you just read the line as is?" I'm like, all right, you want to lower your voice? The mooks from Connecticut gonna hear you. It's what Johnny told me to give you. You got a fucking problem. So now I dropped the F on the second line. It's like, all right, cut. So then I lost that scene. So I'm like, I still regret it to this day. Like,
I loved that show. I owned the DVDs, man.
Yeah, like,
I
really, it was cool, that man. Show. It was cool.
That's dope, man. But on my desk here, you know, like this kid Mike was on my show.
Yeah.
You know, shout out to my boy Robbie, my sponsors, Proper 12. I need a...
Oh, crap. 27 Dresses.
27 Dresses.
This kid, man. It's hilarious.
I bought this just for today, man.
I would be honored.
If you could sign my 27 Dresses copy.
It's going to go right here on the desk,
right?
Yeah,
it's staying on the desk,
bro. Desk of fame. First autograph. How are you?
You like that, man?
I love it. I love it. Yeah, my man.
How does he do it? So, yo, I got to shout out again. Proper 12, the law offices of Stephen M. Reck and Scott Camassar. And then also coming to the podcast, they're not my sponsor yet, but they're going to, Beard Octane. It's a dope beard oil. I'm trying to get on my beard level, man, and they got butters, all kinds of stuff. So check out Beard Octane. I'll have more information on the next show for them. I just bought some stuff from them. It's locally owned and operated. It's a dope company. I'll get some over to you for this little beard,
yeah,
too, bud, for sure. But I got to shout out my sponsors, because without them, I couldn't keep doing this show, man. Shout out to Suave behind the camera, my man. But, Ed, I appreciate you making the trip down from Rhode Island, man. This means the world to me. I really, really had a great time. I hope people dig your story. I know they will.
Yeah, man, same to me. And I appreciate you having me, and I appreciate you all watching. So.
What's up,
thanks,
man.
Buddy.
For sure, buddy.
Drink to finish,
cheers.
Right?
Yeah, man. Cheers.
Shamrock.